So hello everyone and welcome to the EdTech Lounge. For those of you, if you are attending the EdTech Lounge for the first time, EdTech Lounge is a virtual communities of practice. We have been holding these sessions from April 1st, 2020 and successfully conducting these sessions since then. Each week we have a new presenter. And the faculty member shares his and her experience with online and remote teaching, also the challenges. Now I would like to introduce the presenter for our today's session, which is Dr. Revathi Guntru. She's the associate professor in the Medical College, Aga Khan University, Nairobi. Dr. Revathi is currently the section head of microbiology in the Department of Pathology. And she has joined Aga Khan University in 2006 to establish the PGME programs in pathology. And she's played a crucial role in building the section of diagnostic microbiology and establishing the teaching programs in clinical microbiology in Aga Khan University, Nairobi. Prior to joining this position, she has held the position of the department head of laboratory medicine of Kenyatic National Hospital and Associate College of Health Sciences in the University of Nairobi for 8 years. She's received her MD from India. And before moving to Kenya, she's also served in the University of Delhi for 10 years as a faculty member. She has supervised numerous postgraduate dissertation projects throughout her career and published 90 papers in peer-reviewed journals so far. With all of this, she's also a member of several national and international professional bodies, also a number of national advisory committees. And with this brief introduction, now I would like to invite Dr. Revathi Guntru. So over to you.
Thank you very much, Abir, for a very kind introduction. I think at the outset, I must confess that this forum so far has been inviting people with a lot of experience in online teaching. Those who have designed courses, those who have been teaching using a lot of tools, online tools. And I participated in those sessions and I have seen the capacity of those faculty members of our university. And also we had some international members who presented in this forum. But I should confess that I am completely new to online teaching and I am trying to learn some techniques. I have learned, but I haven't mastered them. And also I didn't have much opportunity to make use of them. So I'm a totally novice to online teaching. So perhaps I'm the first person with not much skills, but still presenting to this forum my experiences. Thank you very much for having me today. So quickly, in the coming 15 minutes, what I want to share is the current scenario because of the pandemic. Everybody is forced to do distance learning, distance teaching, and what is happening in the international forum, in the global forum. The experiences I have had learning on distance learning platforms and online platforms, and some of my experiences in teaching on the online platforms. These are beautiful shots of Aga Khan University Hospital, Nairobi. This particular ground floor is our laboratory complex. Somewhere on the right side, ground floor is microbiology laboratory. I'm a clinical microbiologist. This is an automated bacteriology analyzer in my lab. And with the help of this particular machine, which one of my microbiologists is seated there, he's using it, we identify various pathogenic bacteria and we check their antibiotic susceptibility tests. My part of my job, one of the things microbiology unit is doing routinely, and this is how bacteria look like, just to share with you. This is a mixture of bacteria. This is what we are doing every day in that section. Colorful bacteria. Now, this is a report quickly to share with you. An international report just released in September 2019, A World at Risk. This report talks about the dangers of pandemic and how world should prepare for them. And the faculty of John Hopkins Public Health School, they were all on this particular group which made this report, Preparedness for High Impact Respiratory Pathogens and Pandemics. And they actually outlined how globe should prepare for these pandemics. And part of that report also says about online teaching, distance learning methods, and everybody should be prepared for that in case of a dangerous pandemic. And it also delineated tsunami evacuation during COVID, a guide for school administrators. This was by UNDP. So I have already said my talk covers some of my reflections in the backdrop of COVID-19 and e-learning, current global scenario, e-teaching and learning, my experiences with e-learning, and also my e-teaching. One of them is what is called eco-platform, on which currently we are teaching. So coronavirus continues to completely turn upside down all our routines, and the hardest hit sector is education. Classes closed, universities, colleges, schools, everything closed. Libraries are closed and very disruptive for teachers and learners and students. But can we stop teaching and learning? Somehow these classes have to go on. Students have to take exam, they have to graduate, otherwise they lose a whole year. And then next year is going to be better, we don't know. So coronavirus, this lockdown is actually the best test for education technology interventions for distance learning. Who is able to adapt, who is not able to adapt, this was the best acid test. So what has happened now during pandemic is the traditional teacher who's multitasking, this teacher is a role model, is a mentor, is a planner, he's everything, he or she is doing multitasking. This is a traditional teacher, a school teacher or a college teacher, even our own job in pathology department, we are doing so many things, all these things, has become electronic teacher. Okay, now, online education has quickly become a major phenomenon around the world, and it is very convenient, very easy. People can, if they have connectivity and the appropriate gadget, can join from anywhere. And they can learn anything. This is what is assumed. Anything can be taught. Anything can be learned by videos or on virtual platforms. And some countries embraced this technology very, very much, very early, since 20 years ago. But some are leading as a variety of programs, universities, colleges, completely switching to online teaching. And 25 years ago, when my cousins were in US, half of their courses were on laptops. They were only doing half the courses in the classroom. 60% of the courses were doing through videos and other virtual platforms. So already the technology was in place. Only thing, it wasn't being used so popularly. So we had task forces on distance education. This is one of the US universities, but UNDP, UNESCO, all of them commissioned these task forces. And this is an example, World Bank, talking about online education because of COVID, how countries are preparing, coping and planning for recovery. Just flash of examples, Harvard Business School, online, leadership and management. There are so many courses, but they are quite expensive. This is London School of Economics and Political Science. Online degrees, variety of degrees are available. And all these courses are available, short courses of 6 to 8 weeks, all of them are rolled out, much more during the pandemic. And some of the lessons are like bonus, free leadership lesson, 2 hours, 3 hours lesson free, you register, you'll be tempted to take the other course. Okay, what are the characteristics of good online courses? What are the key characteristics? One is active student engagement. Nothing is as boring as a typical lecture, somebody is talking, you are listening to the lecture, and maybe you switch off, you go on mute, you reduce the sound and do something else. Student must be actively engaged. He should be kept interested, involved, and on the toes. That is number one. Number two, having a group online learning technique. You have a study group, or that is a social aspect. And there is a peer group, and you are learning much more from your group. And there is a lot of critique, there is a lot of learning, exchange of ideas, and actively the study group contributes to learning and critiquing. And case-based sessions is also very, very good hallmark of good online teaching platforms and teaching techniques, where there is an example, there is a live scenario, the student actually becomes like an expert. He's being asked, how do you critique this scenario? What is your opinion? So he actually feels, the student, that I have become an expert. So these are some of the examples how to teach online courses. There are courses on this, how to teach the techniques. And this is close to our place, Tanzania, East Africa, campaign for education and information in COVID-19 crisis in Tanzania. Then we also came to know that there are terrible digital divides in distance learning emergency. That is, people who are low resourced, they have no gadgets, they can't afford the smartphone, they can't afford the connectivity, so they are missing on the school, they can't join the class, while the well-resourced families are able to connect their children to these online resources. So the divide has become much more distinct, and it was very, very sad. And there is a commission actually looking at this, because 826 million students, it was realized, out of 1.5 billion students who had to go online because the schools closed due to COVID, but they could not connect to the classes. So it's a burning issue. Okay, what are my experiences with e-teaching and learning? My learning experiences, way back in 1919, I joined a postgraduate diploma course, University of Nairobi, for HIV and STIs. So the entire course was said to be distance learning, but we used to receive hard copies of videos and CDs, which you go home and you play them and you listen to them and you answer some questions, but those are again classroom. The assessments were classroom on hard copy papers. So that was also distance learning. University of Washington Global Health, there are online courses which I have participated. They are on excellent platforms. Canvas is the platform they use. And it has videos, it has interactive sessions, study groups, and individualized learning programs. And it has all the tools which it employs, and excellent programs. Online CME sessions on webinars and Zoom, we have participated since a long time. Now, what is my teaching experience? CBLs on Zoom, our residents switch to Zoom CBLs, and we don't use many more tools on that, but it can become interactive as we discuss the case and we talk to each other, we ask questions and we answer questions, and sometimes some MCQs and quiz can be on the screen and it is discussed. So that is a CBL with which we gained experience. Faculty academic rounds completely switched to Zoom for the college. Online distance mentorship of international interns. Currently I have two interns. I am doing it with the mentorship completely on Zoom and WhatsApp. We meet, we talk, and we exchange papers, we interact, and then we critique, and then we write reports and we exchange them entirely on Zoom and WhatsApp. Then we have WhatsApp groups of multidisciplinary teams, clinicians, pharmacists, nurses, and lab techs who are on a WhatsApp group, and we are supposed to be, Aga Khan University Microbiology is supposed to be providing mentorship for them because they are participating sites for antimicrobial resistance surveillance at national level, and these centers are funded by Fleming Fund for AMR survey, Kenya country grant. So that is another experience we have, but we have a lot of troubles, we have a lot of fruitful interactions also on those groups, and that is an experience. But what I am quickly going to show you is my experience with what is called ECHO platform for Ministry of Health. This is again connecting 30 AMR surveillance sites all over Kenya, And the program is called Extension for Community Healthcare Outcomes. The abbreviation is called ECHO Platform, and it started in 2018. And the project objectives is to provide antimicrobial resistance training to the surveillance sites. Specifically, it offers technical guidance and supervision and support supervision to the Ministry of Health labs and laboratory technologists in Kenya. In addition, strengthening the laboratory systems by training curriculum for the quality management systems. Internal QC, external QC is also part of this program. And the project locations, usually CDC, Center for Disease Control Prevention, USA, American Society of Microbiology, USA, and these are providing the technical support, and the faculty usually join the sessions. Sometimes they provide the materials, and the whole thing is hosted in National Public Health Laboratory Network, the main laboratory in Nairobi. And the platform is used is Zoom, and it offers online training, and the targets are these I have already shared with you, multidisciplinary teams, including veterinary officers working in the county government and private hospitals. A few private centers are also there. The Zoom subscription is yearly paid by New Mexico University, and they join usually some of these sessions to see how their the donation is performing. Now, quickly the summary of the training. The content of the teaching for this program is usually guided by the WHO priority list of pathogens. There is a WHO guidance on this. And there are 5 strategic objectives of the Global Action Plan and National Action Plan for AMR survey. So one of them is strengthening the laboratories. So that particular objective is the key objective for this particular program. Quickly, these are all the sites. The program started with 6 sites, but currently there are 30 sites actually. These are all county referral hospitals. And some of them have good microbiology laboratory, some of them have rudimentary laboratory, but all these technologists and some of the pharmacists, doctors, they do join on the ECHO platform. The session is usually 1 hour and it has 3 parts. One part is a didactic presentation of 15 minutes, which is done usually by the specialist in the National Public Health Laboratory or one of the CDC or ASM or other faculty who are enlisted for support. They make a presentation and they choose a topic, and the topic is circulated and then it is presented. And the part 2 is a case presentation from one of the sites. A technologist brings a case, anything which he felt was challenging, there was an issue, there was a finding, and he shares it with the group. And so that is the part 2 of the presentation. And this site sends this case well in advance, around 2 weeks in advance. And then it goes to a subject matter expert, usually a microbiologist or a clinician who acts as a subject matter expert. And they prepare. And part 3 is now the comments by the subject matter expert on the case and as well as the didactic presentation. And then there is also quality control and discussion after the presentation. There is a lot of questions and answers and exchange, which goes after the session. Currently, I'm acting as a subject matter expert in the past 1.5 years for this particular program. The whole session takes just 1 hour. So what are the highlights? When the program started, we had only 6 sites, but currently we have 30 sites. There is a pre-test, midpoint test, and post-test to measure the learning, how the participants are progressing. There is also survey questionnaires, and also there's a formal examination questionnaire which is circulated, and the candidates are scored online for this. What are the lowlights? Interactive tools are never used, excepting chat box. We have Kahoot, we have Mentimeter, we have Padlet, we have Whiteboard. There are so many interactive tools, but they are hardly ever used in these sessions because the time is very short, more than 1 hour. The technologists don't stick around. There are a lot of challenges. So there is no scope to use any interactive tools. There is a lot of lack of training, lack of awareness, and also everybody is not on his own laptop. They join through a TV screen. About 10 people have joined on one screen. So interactive tools may not be used unless everybody uses their own smartphone. Now, The program successfully completed phase 1, phase 2. Currently, we are in phase 3 from June 2020, and I think I can scroll through all this. These are the questionnaires we circulated to the participants about their satisfaction and their knowledge addition, and also the highest score and the lowest score the participants got pre and post test and midpoint test. And what are the obstacles? Quickly, I want to share with you. Infrastructure is the biggest problem. They don't have connectivity, the gadgets go off, and then there's no maintenance. The county hospital says, the MedSoup says, I have no budget to maintain all these things. These are provided by donors. They have to take care of them. We don't have money. Very weak internet network is another challenge continuously. People try to join with their smartphone, but they don't provide, you know, seamless connectivity. They don't get. Power failure, very, very common. Insufficient recognition of importance of e-learning. Low accessibility to online materials. Low availability of computers, smartphones, or tablets, especially the most vulnerable areas of the counties. The eco challenge is unstable. We have said internet, conflicting duties and responsibilities. The people are scanty on the ground. There is only one pharmacist, only one technologist, and he's on duty. If he sits on this session for 1 hour, there's nobody to cover the duties. That is the biggest challenge. Some of the health facilities are continuously understaffed. Some facilities have only 2 microbiologists. So there is a lot of problem. The other problem is there is lack of reagents and equipment, failure of equipment in the sites. So when the tech is not doing good work, he has no cases to share. Usually it is only 4 labs which are able to do case presentation. So other labs just join. They don't do any case presentation. They don't have the capacity to do case presentations. So sometimes they lose interest and they drop out. So these are all the problems. What are the promises for future? Because of the Fleming grant, some of the university staff from University of Nairobi, they are interested now. They made a curriculum and they want to join this platform. They have already joined and they want to enrich the sessions. And Aga Khan University also planned this with our online teaching specialists who are on the ground. And we want to roll out some of the online modules. And we named it Essentials of Microbiology for AMR Survey. We have already prepared 4 modules on which we want to intensely train the multidisciplinary teams online, make use of online interactive tools, make interesting sessions, and enrich the knowledge base of the survey sites. So we are going to adopt 4 sites, Aga Khan University, and try to see how we can make them build capacity on their own and also progress towards the AMR survey. This is one of the screenshots. On this shot, we have people joining from CDC, ASM, and National Public Health Lab, and some of the sites. And there was a lot of international faculty on this particular call. And tech savvy teams, we salute them. Thank you very much for your attention and challenges of COVID. Thank you.